2016 for our roots, our journey, our city. So first of all, can I ask you your name?
Abdur Rouf.
And can I ask you where you were born?
Born in Bangladesh, a village called Syedpur, the district of Sunderland.
And can you tell me a bit about Syedpur?
Syedpur is a very famous village with a lot of heritage. Most of the inhabitants are of the direct descendant of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. This used to be part of the Indian subcontinent, you know, greater India. About 750 years back, we have a pious Muslim saint came from Arabia, from Yemen, and settled in Syedpur, and we are the direct descendant of him. So most of the inhabitants of Syedpur are Syed, who are a title given to Prophet's daughter by Allah, the God himself. So we are blessed with that. But we also have many other people from different backgrounds who live in Syedpur harmoniously. It's a very big village. We have many educated people, also religious scholars and leaders born in Syedpur. They're all over the world, you know, taking part in world affairs, politics, religious affairs, lots of imams in various countries. And it has about maybe 12 to 15,000 of Syedpur's population live abroad. A greater amount of that is in the UK, which is probably about 10 to 12,000 people from Syedpur. And the biggest portion of that lives in Sunderland. So Syedpur, I'm very proud of Syedpur. It's a very well-known and largest village in Bangladesh.
Can you talk about what your parents did there and what you did growing up?
My father was from a very humble background, but from a very dignified family root. He used to be teacher, an imam, and later on in his life he became a very well-known community leader in Syedpur, who used to mediate when a dispute happens. He was one of the well-known person in village Syedpur that he was the mediator. He also took part in the very first election of Bangladesh after it became independent, and he was elected the member, local member. So he was quite well-known, very famous, very kind and generous person. And my mom, like usually everyone else, she was a housewife, taking care of the home and the children. So that was.
What did people do for livelihoods?
Mostly it's agriculture-based lifestyle in Bangladesh. Back then, most people have a bit of land with which they cultivate and, you know, grow their own crops, mainly rice. And it's a rural area, and you know, they have their own places where they can fish, they grow their own vegetables. So quite self-sufficient on those days. But as the time progressed, you know, the society became more modernized, it became more like urbanized, you know. Not many people grow things themselves, they always buy them from the market. And because economically it wasn't that affluent, so a lot of people went abroad for a better life, looking for a better life. As a consequence, so many people are in UK, in America, in Middle East, earning living and sort of improved their life.
Did you go to school in Syedpur?
I went to school for a small, in primary school,
What was school like?
School was very fun.
Oh, what did you study there?
It was basic up to class 5. Initially, I went to a religious school, and then moved to a more comprehensive type of school. Yeah.
What did you do outside in your free time and inside? But
well, life is much free. You know, you just go to school and then play most of the time. Apart from that, I didn't do much.
What sort of games would kids play?
Kids used to be really enthusiastic about playing football. There are so many local other games as well, like kabaddi. Some play badminton, volleyball. So there's various. Recently it's all cricket craze now. Everybody plays cricket now.
Did you like cricket?
I wasn't really introduced to cricket until very later in life in this country.
Right.
And I thought it was a very slow, you know, so I wasn't very interested in it. But once Bangladesh became well known and involved in the ICC, International Cricket Federation, they were involved in it, and then we became interested. And once I went to see the game in Chesley Street, from then on, it was really interesting. And my family, including my wife and my daughters and my son, they're all very, very much involved in cricket. They love cricket. They always, in fact, they have just bought special sports channel to watch IPL and VPL, you know. So they're very enthusiastic about cricket.
Could you tell me a bit about what Syedpur was like during rainy season?
Well, during rainy season, it's common to get, it's quite lowland, Bangladesh. And monsoons, apart from the homestead, everything gets covered in water. And when the water starts coming in, beginning of the Bengali New Year, I think it's about 1 or 2 couple of months after the New Year, new water, very clear water. All the children play outside in the water all day, you know. And it is necessary for the crops, the rice crops as well. Right. And it stays for about 6 months and then it goes away. And that's how it's a cycle that happens all the time. Mm-hmm. But whenever it reaches certain level, which above the norm, that's when it's classed as a flood. Otherwise, in being in Bangladesh, we don't see normal water as flood. During the monsoon season, normal traveling process was by nauka, which is a boat, mainly paddled with hand. But nowadays, those boats are not used at all because road infrastructure has been improved.
Right.
There's a lot of road works. You can go by car or rickshaws or the small taxis, you know.
Right.
So this is how things have developed now.
When did you come to the UK?
I came in 1975.
Right. Right. Do you remember your journey?
I was quite small, so...
How old were you?
I was about 12 or 13.
You don't remember the actual journey?
Yeah, I remember when I was sitting in the plane, because this was the first experience. I was sitting next to an air hostess, and obviously at that time, I think it was British Airways, and the lady had a skirt on, and the tights on. So, and you can tell the seaming, you can see the contour of the, and when I was watching, I said, how come her leg is like that? It's got like a, I didn't realize, because it was the skin color. I didn't realize she had something on. Later in life, then I realized the ladies wear the skirts and tights. But when I came, that was one thing that I remember. And also, once we got out of the airport, we traveled to Kidderminster in think it's Herefordshire, Worcestershire, in a black cab. And the whole country was covered in snow. That was a shock. This was the first time I saw snow. So that's what I remember. Yeah.
Were you nervous coming?
No, I wasn't.
And why did you come?
Well, I came with the family. So.
Did your family come for better economic prospects?
Yeah.
And the first place you went to was Kidderminster.
Kidderminster.
And how long did you spend there?
I didn't spend that much there. About on and off about 1 year. Then I moved to Sunderland.
Right. Well, what was your time in Kidderminster like?
At that time, around beginning of 1976, there was a lot of racism. So. We experienced quite a bit of that,
right.
Even in the city of Sunderland as well.
Mm.
But things have improved a lot. People have changed. Mm. When we used to work in the restaurant, you know, we were afraid of the weekends. We get a lot of abuse, even outside.
Mm.
But my feeling is that people have changed a lot. People are more accepting.
Mm.
That, you know, this is the reality. There's a lot of people live here. So, things has improved.
Did you go to school in Kidderminster?
I went to school in Kidderminster for a while, and then I went to school in Gateshead.
Okay. Did you speak English when you first came?
No.
Didn't speak any English?
Not much at all.
So, did you learn English at school?
I learned English at school, and after working, you know, generally. And I was quite enthusiastic about learning it, and that's how I picked up.
How long did it take you to learn English?
It didn't take that much, but I think generally it sort of progressed over the years. I mean, I still have a lot more to learn yet of English as well.
What were the other kids at school in Kidderminster like?
As I said, there were a lot of friendly kids as well. But we used to have, you know, the racist abuse from some kids as well. So it was okay. We managed.
Were kids who were racist was it name calling or
name calling you black, this and that, you know? But at that very young age, we weren't very alert about what racism was. We thought that was the normal. School schoolyards arguments, but now, after growing up, we realize that we have been through quite a lot of racism and racial attacks.
And then, why did you move to Sunderland?
Well, one of my uncle invited me to come here. And go to school here, but there wasn't much opportunity, so I went to Gateshead.
Okay.
But on and off, I lived here in Sunderland from 1976 onward.
So did you move to Gateshead? Or?
Yeah, I was in Gateshead for a while. Yeah.
Right.
And I finished school in there.
Right. What was Gateshead like?
Even worse. But it was okay.
Right. It worse in what way, in terms of racism?
Because, they were failing.
Mm.
The people around there. I've experienced quite a bit of that, but it was okay.
And then you moved back to Sunderland?
Yeah, I moved back to Sunderland, yeah.
Right. And what did you do when you got to Sunderland?
And after I left school, I went to work in Hartlepool. And worked there for a few months and then went back to Newcastle and I worked in. At that time, most of our community were single men. Not many people had their family over here. Only few of us had families anyway. So from there on, I went to Bangladesh and after I returned from there, I started working in South Shield and then in Sunderland, and then went back to work in Gateshead once more. And finally, I've settled here in Sunderland from beginning of 1985,
right.
Permanently.
And what did you do for a job?
I started a job in the Shagorika restaurant at Seabank, Sunderland, in 1985, and worked there for a few years. And in 89, I went back to Bangladesh, got married there. And in 90, I got my wife over here. So we started family life from 1990 onward.
Could you tell me a bit about your wedding?
My wedding was a very simple wedding compared to the wedding nowadays. It's very pomp and a lot of expenses. But mine was a very simple wedding with the relative. And once we got married, we stayed there in 6 months. And then we moved back to Leeds, where my in-laws are from. And from there, I moved to Sunderland with my wife and started working in the Shagorika restaurant. And I've been there ever since.
Right. I forgot to ask, could you tell me who your uncle was who invited you up to Sunderland in the first place?
It was Muhammad Shafiq Mia.
So you were working in Sunderland from
1985
forward. Did you try and preserve Bangladeshi culture in Sunderland?
Well, all of us used to get together after work. You know, that was the norm and the culture. We used to, you know, most of the people were single, male, and after work we used to get together and chat about things. But there wasn't much opportunity for preserving cultural things, apart from we used to get videos to watch Bangladeshi or Indian movies. On Sundays we used to go to Townside Cinema. They used to show Asian movie every Sunday. So that was one sort of entertainment, and apart from that, generally, people were going on about their work, as there wasn't any other activities. But in 1986, I think we first created the Bangladeshi Association in Sunderland, of which I was one of the assistant secretary, and the chairman was Syed Jamal Mia, and the secretary was the present chairman of the Bangladeshi Community Center, Mr. Khalid Miawalid, and I was the assistant secretary and also somebody else. So that's from then on, sort of community got organized.
Yeah. Right. What about religion? How did you practice?
We had, when we came here, I think very few people bought a house, which was in Western Hill. I think it still belonged to the mosque. But that was the house that we used to use as a mosque. So you can imagine how many people were, you know. So there weren't many, many people. But God's willing, we have three mosques in Sunderland now. And on Fridays, we don't have enough space to cater for everybody else. So Muslim community have grown very rapidly in this city. And they're very good and polite and gentle people.
When did the first mosque get built?
Well, I don't remember exactly. I think it will be probably 1974 or 1975.
You've said a bit about racism. Did racism get better over time, do you think?
Yes, I think it has got better over time. So at least on the you don't encounter this much nowadays. Before, I think it was well known. Sometimes well known. In the restaurants when we work, we always used to get racial abuse. Even outside, people were attacked and things. But as I say, things has changed and improved a lot. Mm-hmm. Although. It does exist, even still we do encounter it, but not as before.
Mm.
I think the lot of community know that there is a big Asian community, which is of mainly in Sunderland from Bangladeshi origin. There are some other communities as well.
Mm-hmm.
But majority of the ethnic minorities in Sunderland are from Bangladeshi origin and Muslim background.
Mm-hmm.
So people are aware of it. There's kids, they're born here, they're going to school. So, you know, there's a lot of interaction between the indigenous population of Sunderland.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that we are visible now, I think people are accepting it. But I think there is a lot of room for improvement in terms of equality in participation in society, especially from the local government. I don't know how much, how many people they employ and how many black and Asian people they employ in terms of proportion of employees they have. So I think in those fields, there are still a lot of work to be done and things to be improved, hopefully, in future.
What are your other hopes for the future?
My other hope for future is, you know, it's a lovely city, you know, especially where I work, right in front of the sea. It's a beautiful area to work in. I've enjoyed working here, and obviously the business that I've been working from 1985, I bought into it for the last 20 years. It's been good, and I believe a lot of improvement can be done.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in terms of community relation,
mm-hmm.
understanding between different communities, because there's a lot of prejudices happen because of ignorance. You know, people all whom, you know, like my English friends, are so friendly and so understanding. I've never ever, you know, got anything negative from them. So you only get those kind of things, people who you don't know, and they are not aware of the reality of this society and a lot of ignorance about Islam and Muslims, and through media as well, you know, it doesn't help, because I've been following media. Whenever something negative happens, I noticed you would always see somebody Asian or black showing there. Even if anything to do with the benefit, you see an Asian person or a black person standing on the queue. Whereas we are 0.00% of the population, you know. So media nowadays in this modern societies can play a lot to improve the relationship between the community. Because we are all of children of Adam and Eve. We're all human beings, no? Colors and skin colors and languages doesn't make any difference. It's how better person you are inside toward your fellow human being. And you know, how you love your things for your neighbor. Or the, you know, there's a saying in Islam, you know, if your neighbor doesn't feel safe from your tongue and from your hand, then you're not a true Muslim, you know. And it didn't say what kind of neighbor it is. It could be anybody. So, you know, that if we follow this philosophy, then the society will be much better. Everybody think, you know, that way.
What about raising a family in Sunderland? Has that been easy?
Yeah, it's been all right. My children are really happy. They've been to school. They've been to university. Luckily, I've got a big family. Six daughters and one son. And four of my daughters, they've been to university, they're all graduates. One, the oldest one, she did a law degree. The second one did a biomedical science degree. And the third and the fourth, they both did business management degrees. So, and they're working, so it's been okay. But there's not much opportunity in Sunderland in terms of jobs for graduates. And there's few opportunities because we've been lucky. We've got a lot of Asian businesses in Sunderland, like restaurant, takeaways. These are the main places that has been the place of employment for our people. And a lot of people who doesn't have much higher qualification or education, people who came earlier on, who are not born here, they have very few skills, and these businesses have been their, you know, place of employment, and they provided employment and supported their families here and in back home as well. So this has been really good in terms of employment. But new ones, new generation who are being educated here, there isn't much opportunity for them in Sunderland. But as I said before, Sunderland local authority and the biggest employers in Sunderland, they could play a part, because unemployment in ethnic minorities proportionately is very, very high. And if the employment rights are followed on by the employers in terms of equal opportunities, then I think there's so many opportunities can be created in Sunderland itself. I mean, I think Sunderland employs many, many thousands of people. And, you know, if there's a proportion of that, get passed to the ethnic minority, there will be a lot of improvement.
Could I ask a bit about what you think the Bangladeshi community has contributed to Sunderland?
I think Bangladeshi community has contributed because they're very humble people, very law-abiding citizens of the city, very peaceful people. The employment they've created for all these people, that is one contribution. They're paying their taxes. And in terms of cohesion of the community, there's always been proactive in terms of getting friendlier with their neighbor, and they're always friendly. So that's a benefit to the society in terms of diversity as well. Because without diversity, things become dull. You know, you need color in life, in every field and in society. Otherwise, things will become dull. So we have contributed being here, part of Sunderland, playing our part as a responsible citizens of Sunderland and of UK. I think they've contributed greatly, and this is their home. They think, I mean, whenever England is playing Bangladesh, my children are always cheering for England, you know. And I sometimes tease them. I say, oh, you're Bangladeshi, why are you cheering for England? I said, no, you're Bangladeshi, I'm not. I'm born here, you know. Although I've been a British citizen since 1976, but still, you know, born there. So I sometimes tease them that, but you can feel that where they are born, that's where they belong. Their loyalty lies here. You know, they're the Makams, you know. So they feel this is their country, and this is their, of course, yes. And most of my life is being spent here. I went to the graveyard the other day, and I can remember there were only few new graves were dug in. Now you go there, there are hundreds, you know. And most of the people of the community I used to know, you know. So this is home. That's where we belong. And the children, they belong here. They're educated here. They marry here. We grow up here, grow old here, die here, buried here. So this is home.
Could I ask you a bit about the Liberation War?
Yes, I can remember a little bit.
Yeah.
Liberation War was very horrendous. Many, you know, hundreds of thousands of people was killed. It was small, but I did see quite a bit of it locally as well. And people, you know, when we talk about justice and fairness, the Bangladesh, which was East Pakistan before, was very badly treated for 25 years by the people in authority. All being the majority population of the country, it was never given the, you know, never allowed to assume power, despite winning the elections. And in 1969 and 70, when the Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, the founder of Bangladesh, he won landslide in the country, and they've started playing this politics, you know, delaying. And so he was able to, you know, get everybody behind him and said, are said, you know, we're not going to take it anymore. We're not going to be subjugated by people from 2,000 miles away. Although we came as a part of one country, but they've always ruled us being the minority, but they've never given the proportion of the share which was enjoyed by the Pakistani, West Pakistan. East Pakistan being majority population, it wasn't developed, the money wasn't spent here, and it was in every field, like army, navy, air, there wasn't given, you know, the priority. So people realized that, and Sheikh Mujibur Rahman was able to raise their emotion regarding this, and he declared independence. And you know, being Muslim and of the same population, they came hard on the unarmed population of Bangladesh. You know, on the 25th of March, they've killed thousands of people. And for the 9 months, they brutalized the whole nation. But luckily, India, which was our neighbor, they did help Bangladesh in achieving the independence. And I feel really grateful to them. It was before I was born when Pakistan was formed. But I was grateful that Pakistan was formed and Bangladesh was part of Pakistan. And then I was grateful again, Bangladesh was born with the help of India and Russia and whoever. And there was, at that time, I believe there were so many Bangladeshi who were living in this country. They've contributed greatly towards the independence of Bangladesh. They've gave their whole wages and demonstrated and highlighted the fate of the innocent Bangladeshis who are being brutalized by the Pakistani armies. And that, you know, that got the whole world noticed the situation in Bangladesh. And eventually they had to leave Bangladesh, and Bangladesh became independent in 1971. And I feel really proud that we are an independent nation. Although officially I'm a British person, but at heart, I am a Bangladeshi.
Did you experience the war yourself?
I did see some, we have local police station, which was occupied by the Pakistani militia, local militia. When the independence came, we saw the militias were fleeing, and some of our local people who were in the militia as well. So they sort of thrown their weapons and came back home. So we knew that this was happening. We've seen the army. I was at a meeting in our village, in the market, where everybody from our village was gathered there. The Pakistani army came, and only about 5 miles away, they've, on that same day, they've killed so many people. And from there, they came here. And because our village is quite a Islamic-minded, religious-minded people, and we have a lot of Islamic scholars, we have very Islamic school there. And those people, when they saw that these were, you know, Muslim people, somehow spared our village. So we didn't get that action made like in other villages. So luckily we escaped that.
Can you remember how you felt?
Well, at that time we were small. We didn't really feel that much because there wasn't much media. It was only radio, and we were small. We didn't feel as like when we see, like in here, what's going on in Syria. The Assad government, you know, brutalizing the population, you know. We didn't see that much, so that sort of emotion didn't arise then. We only realized afterwards, when everything came out, that how many millions had been killed. And when we see it now, which we didn't saw at that time, we see the media, how thousands of people were killed. And those were the, you know, they used this, their might of army against innocent people to subjugate Bangladesh. But luckily, we did not submit to it. A lot of people who gave their life for the independence of the Bangladesh, I want to say, you know, how proud I am, and I hope their soul rest in peace.
How did you hear that the war had been won?
Well, once those, as I said, when we see those people are fleeing, leaving their station, and it all came well known that, you know, that's when they surrendered and the country became independent.
Right. And how did you feel?
We all feel really proud, and we're all jubilating, you know. We're all jumping in jubilation that, you know, Bangladesh became independent. But as I say, we didn't grasp the actual enormity of becoming an independent country at that time. We were small. Only those people who have fought and given their, you know, life, they knew maybe the most how important and how, you know, enormous the victory was. We were children, we didn't really feel that much. But afterwards, when we start to become, you know, a little bit older, then we realize and we feel really proud.
Do you think Bangladesh has improved since independence?
I think there's always a lot of room for improvement. Over the years, you know, the third world countries, a lot of poverty, and when there's a lot of poverty, that creates a lot of resentment, and the government and people in authority are not, you know, because everybody's in need. So there's a lot of abuse and corruption went on. But I think generally it's getting better. Because of the nowadays, there's a lot of media. If anything happens, and it's more highlighted, people know that. So it will take time, you know, because a family takes a smaller time to change. A village takes even longer. A society and the country takes a long time to change over. I think once the country is improving in education, when people become educated and they are able to read and write what's the situation, things will improve. Because even if you look at history of UK and other developed countries, it wasn't as like what we see now. It took hundreds of years to become improved. So Bangladeshi people are very resilient people, you know. They get a lot of natural disasters like flood, storms, you know, cyclones. And those sort of hampers the progress. You know, you develop so much and one flood comes and it takes you back another 5 years. So this has been one factor in terms of development, which has been stalled over again and again. But I think things are improving. People in education are improving, and people are improving.